Hey everyone, I'm Jason Dean.
And I'm Colby Dane.
And this is Real Physics, where we tell you what would really happen in Hollywood production.
Because our disbelief can only be suspended so far.
Hey everybody, this week Real Physics is checking out the second G.I. Joe movie, Retaliation.
Now there's plenty of stuff in this movie to cover, but we thought the Project Zeus missile was the goofiest thing we wanted to know about.
And knowing is half the battle!
Let's take a look.
Okay, so here we see the mean old President of the United States about to wreak havoc on the rest of the world.
But is he really the President? You probably don't need to watch the movie to know the answer to that.
So they get ready to fire their super weapon to prove to the rest of the world how awesome they are. And we get to hear the President describe the weapon ammo as a platinum tube with a tungsten rod.
Now, what's his President's face mentions the rods as being in a tube of platinum, but you know, I think that was just for bling since the melting temperature of platinum is about two-thirds that of tungsten.
And here comes Cobra Commander to help drive home how evil the President is.
Yeah, he finishes the description of the evil weapon by saying they drop the ammo while gravity does the rest.
And back to the President saying it drops 8 times faster than a bullet. That's not very fast, with a force significantly greater than a nuclear warhead.
So the tungsten rod just hits southwest of the Palace of Westminster, making an absolutely implausible ping noise.
Let's listen.
First of all, if you're in a helicopter flying that far away, it's going to take a few seconds for the sound to get to you. Instantaneously hearing the noise is almost as bad as sound in space. Oh, wait. They did that too.
Anyway, we clearly see a large portion of the Thames River getting pushed up into the air. And who is filming this anyway? I mean, what camera feed are they watching from this room? When everyone is overwhelmed with the London destruction cam footage, they ask what the bad guys want.
What is it you want?
This is my favorite part. Cobra Commander breaks into a Queen song.
I want it all.
Okay, so what we want to know is how much destruction would actually happen when the tungsten rod hit the ground?
And why is being made of tungsten so important?
Would it level London or just make a hole?
Does something like this even exist?
And how much energy is required to actually get the River Thames raised that high up in the air?
It's a good question, but first, some research.
So first of all, they chose tungsten because of its extremely high melting point, as well as its density. As for the weapon design, believe it or not, this is based on a real experimental weapon conceived by the US military a long time ago.
Project Thor is a program that was conceived in the 1950s and was later expanded on in the 2000s. It is a scalable system that could utilize small rods or 20-foot-long telephone pole-sized rods for maximum destruction.
As late as 2003, United States Air Force reports described rod drops from low Earth orbits yielding 11.5 equivalent tons of TNT with an impact velocity of Mach 10, or around 7,500 miles per hour.
But we are going to take a shot at calculating our own velocities later.
Okay, so would a Thor rod have the kinetic energy enough to just rock a city block or clash with all of London?
We're gonna need to look at the amount of destruction that's going on here.
Yeah, in the clip, there is some serious earth and water moving in there.
Okay, we're gonna focus on the water.
Well, what are you waiting for? You know, water?
Let's do some math. We're going to call the average change in elevation of the Thames 30 meters.
We see some of the largest displacement at the Waterloo Bridge, and here the river is around 350 meters wide.
At the Westminster Bridge, just around the bend from the Waterloo, the water depth is about 7.7 meters. This depth, of course, varies as you cross, so we are going to use half that depth when calculating the volume of the water.
Now, the length of the Thames that seems to be affected in the clip is around 2.5 kilometers long.
Now, we calculate the energy required to lift that much water.
First, let's define the mass of the water with this equation. And that comes out to 3.3 billion kilograms.
The energy to lift that much water is just the mass times the acceleration of gravity times the change in height. So the energy required to lift that much water comes out to 991,084 megajoules. Okay, did I mention that this doesn't even include the mass of the ground that's pushing up the water, or the mass of the ground that's pushing up the buildings themselves, or the palaces, or the Ferris wheel, or the light, the heat, or the ping? No?
That's worst case scenario though, and let's just ignore that for now.
So from some research, we found that 1 kiloton of TNT is worth 4.184 terajoules of energy.
So that means 1 pound of TNT is worth a little over 2 megajoules of energy.
So how many pounds of conventional explosives would be required to rock the River Thames?
Well, that ends up being 237 conventional 2,000-pound bombs.
Now that seems like a lot, but considering that London withstood over 30,000 conventional bombs during the World War II German offensive, the Blitz, the smallest of which were about 2,000 pounds, it gives some perspective on just how small this impact really is.
30,000 bombs dropped on London? Damn.
Anyway, let's look at the kinetic energy of a telephone pole-sized rod of tungsten dropped from orbit.
Now, we would choose geosynchronous orbit since it is a high orbit, but one of the advantages of the Thor system is that it has a negligible thermal signature at launch from a moving platform.
Furthermore, getting 9 friggin' tons of tungsten into high orbit is going to require more than a few gallons of petrol. Getting multiple rods that would necessitate a loading mechanism is a feat.
So, we are going to choose a more modest, low-Earth orbit of about 800 kilometers, which puts the Thor satellite at an orbital velocity of about 7.8 kilometers a second.
Added to that is going to be the fall to Earth. Now, to lend the scene some credit, we're going to ignore both air drag and variations in gravity.
So, we need to calculate the energy of a rod falling from orbit.
Okay, so the mass of a rod is the length times the cross-section times the density.
And that comes out to 8,500 kilograms, or almost 19,000 pounds.
Okay, from this equation, we can use an initial velocity of 7.8 kilometers per second, which is its orbital velocity, and get its final velocity as if it were dropped straight down.
Now, we can see from the scene that it does not fall straight down to London, or at least not until it hits, which is another obvious flub here. It strangely manages to turn completely perpendicular to the ground in the last second.
But since we are not considering air resistance, we're going to let this slide. Solving for V sub 1 and plugging in our known variables gives us the strike velocity.
And that comes out to 8,700 meters per second, or almost 20,000 miles per hour.
Man, I wish my rods went that fast. You like in my engine.
Oh yeah.
Oh, what were you thinking?
Nothing. Let's just go ahead and find the energy of the rod. Okay, so solving for the potential energy brings us to our old friend, the kinetic energy equation.
And that comes out to 328,000 megajoules.
Now let's equate that to a force of dynamite, and we get 71,000 kilograms of TNT, or around 78 tons.
That's only 0.08 kilotons, which is really not that much at all.
You know, Hiroshima, by comparison, was more than 191 times more powerful. And even at that, still only would provide about a third of the energy required to lift the River Thames 30 meters by our calculations.
So again, even if you ignored all the energy it would have taken to lift all that ground, plus all the light and the sound and the air resistance and the gravity variations, there's still enough energy in a telephone pole-sized tungsten rod.
All right, well, let's call it.
By Joe, this is Real Physics.
All right, well, there you have it. Until next time, thanks for watching.
See you next week. Now, what's his... Yeah, can you make it a little bit bigger for me? Thank you. Thank you, sweetie.
Would it level London or just make a hole?
A lot of destruction.
Remember back early on when you like, when I said something stupid and you were like, really? This is one of those.
You're supposed to go, you're supposed to be like. Great, but we're gonna look at the water first.
What are you waiting for?
A good take.
That's awesome. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna change the password on my router to unsecured. So when people say, hey man, I want to get on your internet, what's your router password?
It's unsecured.
Unsecured.
And they go, and damn, like, I can't get in.
Wait a minute, guest?
It's a guest and guest, right? It's unsecured. It's like changing your name to free beer. Like, really? Tonight, it's free beer. Stupid. It's as much calories in as in a Subway, like, meatball sub. Don't tell Jared. One of these days that guy's gonna call us. He's gonna go, hey, I watch your show and I'm tired of this crap.
Well, you know what? Let's lure him to the show by sitting out Subway sandwiches like Hansel and Gretel.
Ground light sound, air resistance, gravity variations. There isn't enough energy in a telephone pile. Says tungsten run. Bye, Joe.
I turned in slow motion.
That's only 0.05. What'd you think they were doing, Jason? They're in there playing Parcheesi.
Parcheesi, I love that game.
Me too.
Do you have it?
It sounds like it's an STD or something. Like, do you have Parcheesi? Yes, I did, but I saw a doctor and it's all gone now.
I haven't heard of that game in forever.
I have never played that game in my life.
Parcheesi?
Yes. I always thought it was part fun, but also part cheesy.